Hello everyone, this is Zoltar, and this segment is here to let you know that after about a year of producing content for Offworld Training Company, Mohawk Games contracted me out to do some QA consulting work for them. This video was made during the time that contract was active. Thank you for listening, please enjoy the video. Right, hello everyone and welcome to game number one, round four, the last of our initial rounds today for our FFA tournament. Today we've got Year-End NSYNC, Game Slayer, and Dermis as our competitors. Should be some pretty good matches. No weak players in this group, that's for sure. So, looking around this map, I am seeing a lot of iron, a lot of aluminum, but also definitely at least one or two scavenger spots, so I genuinely have no idea what our players are going to elect to do here.
Oh man, power is going to be huge. The colony's consuming it, and they're only 5 geos. There's a good power robot spot in the northwest.
Yeah, I did spot that up there with the aluminum and the silicon. And then another thing I want to point out, and you can see Year-End as our first to found, just kind of noticed this as well. Water is looking super awkward this map. There are only 2 patches, both on this southern side, and only 1 high tile, which Year-End has already claimed and put a steel mill on. So that could potentially be very interesting this game, I think. Now, despite that, we do see that Dermis has gone into a water pump and 2 farms. He did notice that extremely high food starting price, and I do believe also the very low water starting price. So he's just going to be trying HQ level 1. It's a very bold move, but I like it. Trying to make money off of that food immediately and use that to go ahead and push to HQ level 2.
Worth noting that nobody's really making steel for the most part. So I don't know how Game Slayer is going to do being able to upgrade if that power price dies. Colony expanded.
Yeah,
nobody's making his steel since so as that starts to creep up, he doesn't really have access to good iron or anything like that. So
yeah, he is definitely going to be hoping that Dermis perhaps uses his iron HQ level 2 and moves into steel. For now, NSYNC has managed to push to HQ 2 himself, so we should see a significant amount of steel production coming down in just a moment here. There we are. NSYNC's got the triangle going. He wanted to make sure to grab these water pumps first, it would appear. Year-End with the triangle. We'll just have to see how things go from here. Oh, well, there you go. Gameslayer says fine. Forget my power. Works just fine for me. So plenty of steel on the map now. Just Dermis going to be looking to clean things up. Seems to be struggling a little bit with his initial opening. Decided already to even move out of his one of his farms and into the water pump that he built instead.
I'm really liking Gameslayer's position right now, because if you notice, NSYNC is auto-selling all of his excess iron, so that's going to keep the iron price down for Gameslayer, who has no access to it.
Yeah, I absolutely did notice that. I think that is very, very nice for Gameslayer, and possibly what led to his decision to go ahead and move into these steel mills is this basic idea that NSYNC is really kind of relying on using these combination tiles, and he's going to be wanting to gather up a lot of iron, a lot of aluminum, just to get full benefit from those. So it's a nice move, I think, to try and make this happen for him. However, somebody's trying to be a little bit difficult here. Year-End buying up 200 iron so far, really trying to keep that price high, punish Gameslayer for his current move, and Dermis as well, who's moved in to steal no iron. Robotic colony expanded. I gotta say though, NSYNC has to be loving this, and you can tell he is the first to HQ level 3. Gameslayer still getting there just fine on the back of that very, very expensive power. So I think that both of them are doing okay. Year-End maybe trying to make this play happen just wasn't the right move. Should have been focusing a little more on himself. He also has a little extra glass bot up at this point. 60 instead of 40. Not entirely sure why that is. Possibly looking at farms HQ 3. But it is just a little cash sitting around for no really obvious reason at the moment.
Wow, that was a geo for 9,000 with power up at 150. I know Gameslayer doesn't want to take it because he doesn't want to go into debt, but I mean, that was cheap.
I would agree with you there. Now, to be fair, Dermis did already have his own geotherm. On the other hand, 2 geotherms, power at 150. That's just fine, in my opinion. NSYNC also already sitting on a geotherm tile, but I still think 9,000. That certainly is not much to have to pay to get an extra tile for the rest of the game. right. Well, Yerand has managed to push to 3 as well. Just Dermis stuck back on 2. Dermis, it is worth pointing out, has managed to use this Geotherm to pay through his debt, and so he's now in a very similar position to Gameslayer, making money off that expensive power price. That said, man, Gameslayer's making a lot of money on these solar panels. He's just got so much more power production going on during the daytime.
I'd like to see Gameslayer or somebody go into reactors. That's a pretty high price. That's an untapped market right now. Nobody really has anything.
Yeah, even Yerand, who was getting into this food market pretty late compared to the other two players. I mean, getting into this water market in general, chooses food instead of reactors, and you can just see on the graph what's happening to food right now. It is just dying off so quickly. All these players producing it. It is worth noting that Yerand is the only one truly auto-selling, so everyone else, they're kind of just, in a way, losing money as they're making this food. And Yerand is getting the best, it would look like, the best price for this food production. But look at that price drop. That's insane. Everybody's going to have to reconsider what they're doing. And I do like to point out that Gameslayer did do, as you were suggesting, recommending as the best course of action, moving on into those reactors.
Oh, and NSYNC is auto-selling water as well, so NSYNC is just feeding into Gameslayer in terms of being able to keep those steel mills and the reactors online. Oh, and now a boost.
Ooh.
Wow.
Yep, adrenaline boost on the power is nice. That nuke, though, that's a little frustrating. Not too bad, though. Just looks like his aluminum got knocked out a little bit. Or not aluminum, I apologize, silicon.
Gameslayer could make a run at somebody if they try to upgrade to HQ4 at this point.
Yeah, that's very true.
Very expansive.
He is definitely a pretty major threat right now. Although feeling comfortable enough, he notices that power has dropped off. This is always an important thing to recognize in transition, is that you can start bidding on auctions at this stage of the game, especially an auction like this Pleasure Dome. 3 expansives on the map, 5 adjacency. This is pretty valuable building right here. 8,000. Although I will say 28's probably pushing it, but look at that, $228 immediately started flowing into his pockets just on the back of that auction. That's going to be pretty great for Gameslayer, I would say. I mean, and the other thing is, alright, he sacrificed some debt, but as you said earlier, he was already starting to threaten these players if they upgraded too quickly, if they didn't play safe, and this Pleasure Dome just adds to that. Adds some debt, but he wasn't making that much off power anyway.
There you go, he's going after Yerand.
Yep.
That would be a good pickup too. Yerand's got some good production in his electronics manufacturing, and he's an HQ4 expansive. I mean, that'll really boost his stock if he can get that one last purchase.
Yerand. Yeah. Yerand, you had the ability to defend yourself, but did not. He had an optimization center building as he was being killed off by Gameslayer. Could have easily canceled that, gotten back 80 steel, sold it off for approximately 100 apiece at the time. Easily would have defended himself, I do believe, if he had done that type of move, but was not meant to be, and Yerand is going to be the first casualty of this game. Already making Gameslayer 100 a second. That is not too bad for a majority buy subsidiary.
Wow. I would look to see Gameslayer going into some of these electronics now that he's got carbon scrubbing, and there you go. He's actually getting in now. That's going to make him a whole lot of money at this point.
Absolutely. I do love that carbon scrubbing play this game. Purely because one thing we didn't really talk about a whole lot, but was happening in the background this whole time, is the colony started with these 6 machine shops, as they're now called. And so those have just been eating electronics like crazy, driving that price sky high. Love to see optimization centers to go along with that to help out that electronics production. But for now, even just the carbon scrubbing, you're absolutely right, is going to be huge in helping Gameslayer make a profit off of this situation.
And based on his location, he didn't really have a good access to carbon, so he kind of created a market just by getting that. So now he can go into all those carbon-based items and really make some serious money, because that's where a lot of the money is in the chems and in the electronics at this point.
Absolutely. I do want to point out, just for amusement's sake, that our subsidiary is the first one to hit HQ level 5. I think it's the first time I've ever seen an eliminated player hit HQ 5 first. But indicating maybe that was a good buy for Gameslayer. Now suddenly he's not making money off the subsidiary anymore as it dumped all its cash into that upgrade. However, long term, could work out very well for him. 9,000.
12.
I think another potentially huge deal this game is the fact that the subsidiary actually owns the best water on the map right now, I would say. They've got that high tile, the ability to get to those lows, and of course, subsidiary is auto-selling the whole time. That helps keep those water markets open for GameSlayer, because it's just going to keep knocking that water price down potentially over time if the subsidiary chooses to transition into it. Always interesting to see what the AI chooses to do, though. One can never be too sure.
For some reason, did I just see that right, that GameSlayer sabotaged his own subsidiary?
Well, I know GameSlayer hit NSYNC.
Oh, no, I'm sorry, NSYNC. Never mind. Oh, that's right. I was looking at the wrong person.
It's all good. But yeah, electronics and steel getting knocked out there. Exactly the kind of thing GameSlayer wants to do. His own electronics knocked out for the moment. Not going to be too happy about that. Just starting to add on to them, making sure that he gets the best of that market. Meanwhile, Derma's still back at HQ level 3, but he has grabbed a couple of important patents here. Running superconductor for his geotherm. Always nice. Even with the power at $9 right now, eventually it'll probably creep back up. And then nanotech and thinking machines, making him resistant to that fluctuating steel market. And, of course, the black market options that are available this game. In particular, the EMPs and
Munis. The black market is online.
Ooh, GameSlayer with teleportation. Now he can go out and get some of those things like water and other things like carbon and try to get into those markets.
Yeah, still got HQ5 left, and I think it's always great when you get teleportation before you're finished claiming all your tiles, because then at least you can do some planning in the late stage of the game, based around the fact that you don't have to actually transport those resources back. Another thing we haven't really talked a whole lot about yet this game, but the subsidiary is using quite well at the moment, is the fact that Yearend, one of the reasons I loved his found was it was on dry ice. It was the only person who really had good access to dry ice this game, and right now that is making GameSlayer absolute bank on the back of this carbon, $112 a piece at the moment, 4 solar condensers. Ready to go for year-end subsidiary.
I'm a little surprised that NSYNC hasn't gone. He's got a whole bunch of money, and he hasn't gone for an off-world yet. That's about 60K, but launches are looking really good for Oxygen. You can get 57K out of a launch there. I'm really surprised he hasn't transitioned.
Yeah, and it is also problematic for NSYNC. He's got this patent lab sitting here doing nothing. I believe he may have been after something, but has been blocked to it each and every time, assuming that he started technology at some point. And I don't know if there's a whole lot left that's great to pick up here. Like financial instruments, this game, nobody's really let things get out of control. Perpetual motion and cold fusion, power are both cheap. Energy vault, kind of similar situation. He's running on a geotherm anyway. It's just a bit of an awkward situation, that patent lab. So I like to see his transitioning that into an optimization center.
Yeah, it looks like he just scrapped that, so.
Yeah.
And no holograms on the market, but I mean, it's possible that you could, I mean, especially if he put his off-world right there where his patent lab was. I mean, he's already got a goon squad for it. He's already got an adrenaline boost, so there's not much that can really attack it with EMPs that expensive.
Yeah, just the mutinies being the only thing you have to worry about, but mutinies okay to defend against. You just kind of need some of your own. Every single time you catch a mutiny, it defends against the next. Always, you know, an easier time, I would say, than having to deal with the dynamite situation. So I do agree with you. NSYNC needs to make some kind of aggressive move here, because as the game continues on, it just turns more and more heavily in GameSlayer's favor as Yearend keeps gathering up so much money for him. Look at this. This is an $800 majority buy subsidiary. That is really nice. If he bought the rest of those, how much money would that be making? Over 1,000 easily. Probably closer to 1,200, 1,300.
Just taking a look at Dermis's headquarters, it looks like he still has a couple of solar panels there. He's got a whole bunch of water, but all those are pretty much dead tiles. I mean, he needs to transition his patent lab over to an engineering lab, or if he can afford it, an off-world, but he's not quite there yet, because off-worlds have been getting more and more expensive. So I would have liked to see NSYNC get his off-world down early when it was around 50K and he was sitting around 140K. But now it's almost, I mean, he needs to get in there quickly. Oh, and he's going after Dermis instead of securing himself. I don't know if I like that.
Yeah, and he had started this earlier, then sold out of it. NSYNC just being a little bit too much trepidation, I would say, in how he's handling these situations. He's not committing completely to one idea or the other. He keeps seeming to change his mind, which can always be a bit difficult. Whereas Gameslayer, he's had a game plan going ever since the start of this game. He put down power, he developed a huge war chest, he killed the vulnerable person, who happened to be quite valuable. Now he's just transitioned into an off-world that's easily protected under one of his initial goon squads from this game. So everything's worked out very, very well for him. Like, the only detail he's possibly lacking that he might really want in this situation would be thinking machines. But at the end of the day, once again, Black Market not particularly powerful against those off-worlds, so I think he's just doing just fine transitioning here into the late game.
It looks like NSYNC's total value's bugged. There's no way he's worth $1.2 million. He's got to be worth way more than that when everybody else is in, like, the $2 million range.
Let's see. Total value. Yeah, that should probably say 2.2.
Yeah, but he's the only one. He's the only one, really. So that's interesting.
Well, what's it subtracting there for? Well, year-end says that there. I'm actually curious about this now.
Yeah, your end's 2.2, Gameslayer's 1.9, Dermis is 1.9, and then NSYNC's like 1.2.
I think that's just subtracting the debt, though. Like, NSYNC, he's only at that B rating, but he is in that $200,000 worth of debt, which is removing $1 million from his total value. But that is worth paying attention to, purely because it is what's causing his stock price to be so low right now, despite the fact that he's bought up 5 shares from Dermis. You would expect his stock price to be much higher. But it's just the hasn't paid down his debt, might need to commit to that at some point after he secured his own stock. Gameslayer just committing more and more into his own subsidiary. I definitely like this move, I think. Like, he's got a lead. He can just keep developing it. Yeah, it's not an off-world market subsidiary. Who cares? It's making 1.6 thousand a second. That's fantastic. He's definitely made the value of
that's the equivalent of having about 3 off-worlds on there when everybody else has 0. I don't even think anybody else has a shot at this point. I think NSYNC went after the wrong person instead of going after an off-world, and now Gameslayer is just making 74k per launch.
Yeah, and this is something you'll see happen a lot, honestly. Like, the leading player will take out somebody. Doesn't really matter who. Number 2, number 3, number 4, whatever. But then number 2 and number 3 from that stage on will start butting heads, and it just lets the leading player fly on through the game. Of course, our stock system at some point got changed up to kind of alleviate some of this and make it easier for the two players to work together. But unfortunately, that's not what we saw happen here today. And I think it's going to let Gameslayer run away with game number 1 from here on out. I think you're exactly right.
I would almost sell out of Dermis at this point and just go full on into NSYNC, knowing that as soon as you get him, your stock price is really going to shoot up.
Yeah, on top of that, NSYNC just being so cheap right now, relatively speaking. $18 stock price. He's working on paying down his debt now, trying to raise that stock price, but it feels like it's just going to be too little too late. Gameslayer operating on double off-worlds that he's been adrenaline boosting. Working with this subsidiary, which has not doing so well in terms of cash anymore as it's making its transitions. But still certainly worth something. And NSYNC,
Dermis has his off-world up, but I don't really know what he can do. He's still at HQ4, and I think this one's over.
Yeah, I don't want to get too doom and gloom about it, but I mean, if we just look, we can go ahead and check out some other details we haven't really looked at so far, like the optimization center. Dermis doing very well on food. Food, a very strong launch, always a nice thing to have in his favor. But if we just check out Gameslayer instead, well, he's got oxygen done. Oxygen is a nice launch as well. Not as valuable as food, certainly, but still decent. He's working on some silicon now, so they're pretty similar in terms of optimizations. NSYNC, he's just spread all across the board, and now he's dead, so his spread is particularly irrelevant at this point. And Dermis against Gameslayer. Is there any edge that Dermis has here? Somehow, I don't think so. It's just thinking machines. And both players have been basically ignoring each other in terms of Black Market, so I doubt that's going to make any difference in the world.
And Dermis is going for the second off-world, but it's way too late for that. There's no way to make up this ground.
Yeah, $33 stock price to 76. You can pretty much just call this one here. I mean, two off-worlds to only... Yeah, second off-world is only 2/3 of the way done.
he's never going to get a launch off.
Absolutely. Gameslayer just going further and further into Dermis, making sure that he gets that stock bought up, raises his own stock price, just makes anything, everything worse. Let's see. Trying to think. Total cost is probably about 1.6 million for Dermis right now to finish things up, whereas Gameslayer, he's going to be looking more at 340,000. So I think we can pretty much go ahead and call this one. I'm going to go ahead and look at charts and graphs to kind of see how things ended up the way they did. If we just go on over to Gameslayer, his purchased and sold on power is actually about equal, but this is what's so important, is his selling came early and his buying came late. And of course, that works out very, very well for you almost every single time. If you end up with numbers that are about equal, but you sold everything early, that was money you could have put into investing. The early money is always so much more valuable than the late money. And he made a lot on power this game, 140,000.
Off-world shipment launched.
Look at, we can also see electronics were really Gameslayer's late game powerhouse resource, making about 450,000 on those totals so far this game, and allowing him to transition so cleanly into the off-worlds where he's made another 700,000 approximately thus far. It's just strong, clean transitions out of Gameslayer all game, I would say, and everybody else is just going to have to step it up a notch to keep up. That's
the entire game. Gameslayer has been making money, so when he had to transition out of something, he got carbon scrubbing, so then he can go into more markets he wouldn't have had access to. So, and there we go.
Absolutely, that is going to clean up the game. And I think you're exactly right there. That carbon scrubbing was so crucial for him in opening up those late game markets so that he would have access to them, because there wasn't really a whole lot of other places for him to fit in. It kind of went from power to reactors, and then with carbon scrubbing into electronics, and then finally into the off-world to clean up that game. It was just very clean, straightforward the entire time. It was a really big deal, I think, that unlike other players we've seen throughout the tournament, he didn't get to this point, get a buyout done, and then stall. He had a plan to move forward with that carbon scrubbing, and that was just so crucial to him this game. Let's see. Another thing to look at, not too much activity on the black market, but I suppose that's to be expected. This game, only EMPs and mutinies available to really get super aggressive with. Underground nukes we did see a few of, which are certainly a nice idea. Magnetic storms nobody used, and I have to question that. I think there were some times when magnetic storms could have been quite valuable, but they are, of course, a difficult black market effect to keep track of effectively.
And worth noting that NSYNC put that patent lab up but never got a single patent. So he just spent all that money for it but never got a chance to get anything substantial done with it, unfortunately. So then he just tore it down.
Absolutely. All that money and all that time, because patent lab does not take an insignificant period of time to build at all.
And it's expensive early on when you've got to do that, when you got to take care of that glass. So.
Absolutely. Okay. Now, one thing to point out there is I think Year End was generally doing very, very well that game up until the point that he died, right? And so if he can just clean up that one minor detail of letting himself get bought out, then Year End could definitely pull it back and show something interesting in any further games that we have today. So I'm going to be looking forward to that. Is there anything else you're interested in talking about from that one, or shall we go ahead and move on to game number two?
I think it's time for game number two.
All right, let's get to it. Right, hello everyone, and welcome to game number two, round four of our FFA tournament. Gameslayer, Year-End, NSYNC, and Dermis participating in this one. Gameslayer taking game number one very, very easily, it seems. Strong transitions throughout, managed to get through that entire game very, very well. This map, once again, we have a very large number of resources here. I'm also seeing potentially two different scavenger spots, despite the very low amount of carbon that we've got going on, so I have no idea where people are going to go this game.
I would be terrified to go scavenger right now with nukes on the market. I'd be going scientific, just like what Dermis did, just to watch out for those nukes. And it's not really advantageous to go expansive right now, because if you look at the off-world markets, they're just horrendous. the best launch is Electronics at 19K.
Yeah. Those will, of course, be moving up as the game progresses, but anytime soon, it's very unlikely, you're correct, that Offworld Markets will be valuable at all. I gotta say, Dermis, he had a bit of an early found at $30,000 of debt, but I really love this spot. Silicon, water, and steel all right there. What more could you ask for as a scientist? That's just incredible. Yurand finally deciding to drop a power robot. Gonna go for it this game. Just like Gameslayer did the last. Definitely has access to the silicon that he needs for now. Also has decent water and aluminum nearby. Once again, no iron, so he will be relying on everybody else to make that steel. I don't think that's gonna go as well this game, though.
I don't know if I really like him going power robot with the solar panels when he's on the side of a cliff and the carbon's $8.
Yeah, it is quite possible that maybe an option was to go ahead and move into those wind turbines. More consistent power, a little bit less vulnerable to the black market because, of course, it lasts the entire day and not only part of the day. And with something like power surges available, I think that's definitely worth paying attention to this game.
And then if you think about it, if you go wind instead of solar, if there's a dust storm that comes by, it helps you. Meanwhile, the dust storm pretty much kills your power production the other way. So you get consistent power. It seems like it's really been buffed a lot that I'd rather go wind most of the time than solar just for that reason. There's nothing that really takes down the wind's power.
Absolutely. You're exactly correct. The random effect of the dust storm harming solar panels is something that I think is... A lot of players don't like it, but almost nobody actually plays around it when they have the option to. It's definitely something to consider. I am a little bit concerned about NSYNC's opening here. I definitely understand it. Going for that aluminum, making sure you've got that grabbed up. Aluminum is quite valuable, but I think I might have liked to see a little bit more steel out of him. Steel and iron in particular. You don't sell the iron down. You keep it high, but you can kind of force Gameslayer out of that steel market, force Yurand out of that steel market. I'll get the right player eventually. And then it's just you and Dermis in control of steel. Expanded. That's potentially a lot of money in your pocket long term over the course of this game.
I'm really surprised NSYNC didn't go, say, scientist in that spot, because you've only got magnetic storms there, and you could stretch out that water a little bit with slant drilling if you needed to, plus your... you're not going to get hit with those underground nukes. So he's got access to the silicon right there, he's got access to the water, and then he's got all the iron he needs, so...
Yeah. Absolutely. Optimization Center already, another day two Optimization Center, and this one is insane.
This one is going to be huge, mostly because if you look at those... you're not going to make a lot of money for a while off-world, so you got to make it on-world.
That is absolutely correct. And on-world's looking pretty okay right now. I also love the Optimization Center when you've got these machine shops on the map, like dragging up electronics that nobody else wants to make.
Wow. 28,000. I definitely would have pushed it into the high 30s for that.
Yeah, I'm a little surprised, honestly, that Dermis manages to get a hold of that, as he did found so early that his debt was so high. It's very difficult for him to find the space to afford this 28,000. You can see he's already 80,000 in debt. Kind of just relying on everybody else for power at the moment as well. Doesn't have any of it down himself. He is going to have to be concerned about that. Make sure he keeps a hold of that moving forward in this game. Otherwise, we could see him fall out very easily once the interest starts coming in. Man, I just so desperately want to see nukes on a Gameslayer's iron right now. It's not even funny. Honestly, like, it's so far away. It's medium and low. It's perfect. It's just perfect to nuke out if you want to keep a hold of that iron market, which I think NSYNC has some really good motivation for doing right now.
Oh no, did Gameslayer grab both of the two geothermals on the map before NSYNC could get to him? I see one. Yeah, he got both of them, so...
Ooh. Unfortunate. Now, I will say NSYNC does have access to... quite a bit to some silicon nearby, like solar panels, not that difficult to move into. He's also got these cliffs near him, carbon rather cheap. He's got options, I think, for power.
Yes.
Here. Scientific colony expanded. But it's always just nice to have the geotherms, isn't it? That's just what you want.
Interesting that Yearend decided to boost his farms there. I'm not sure if... I don't know how I feel about that. With power at 180 and you've got your three solar panels, I almost would have done that instead.
The reason I don't mind the farm boost is, in particular, it feels like it's just securing that you're going to have something good rather than putting all your eggs in one basket, right? Mm-hmm. If you get power surged out in one location, that's okay. You've got another great location. And you can see they're making kind of similar amounts of money. The power solar panels are certainly better. But I like this idea, this diversification.
Yeah, I can see that. Looking at it, though, you're boosting a water that's not doing very much. You're boosting two farms versus if you look at the solar, you could be making, you know, $500-$600 a second for each of those.
Oh, absolutely. And I think if you're going to go for that play, I would have liked to see a transition into that third farm for the triangle there. And I think that really would have cleaned it up. Still a nice idea, though, I would say. Oh, come on, 6K. Okay, good. I'm not going to let a 6K claim go by. Got concerned for a moment. Now, I want to look back at this optimization center because Dermis, he is having some serious trouble now. He dropped solar panels, but they immediately all got frozen. He's down in that B level of debt, 141,000. And he is going to need to do something about that moving forward this game. And I'm curious how much he's gotten done with his optimization center. A little bit of steel production, a little bit of glass, but glass is worthless. Well, not worthless, but 82 for glass, that's not much. And he's working on power now, but of course all of his power has been knocked out because he was forced to go solar panels. Just very... bit of a difficult situation for him, potentially, unless he cleans this up. I'm very concerned about it moving forward this game.
More adrenaline. I like Game Slayer's early move into teleportation there, so he can cut down all that fuel cost he's spending with his iron shipping it halfway across the map.
Yeah, that's pretty much all it affects for the time being. He's got a little bit of water separated, but you can see that Game Slayer only in, he's still under $100,000 worth of debt, but his bond rating is terrible because, of course, he's still HQ level 3. And he needs to resolve this, I think, before the interest tick comes in about, you know, 2 in-game hours. All right, and the upgrade should do it.
He finally got his second Geo on, but you know now power is down to 67 and dropping. So that was a dead tile for a really long time.
Absolutely, and it was just so far away. And another thing I want to look at is a geotherm that far away. Yeah, I get it. They're the only two geotherms on the map. That's great, but there's dynamite in this game.
Dynamite, yeah.
And you definitely don't want to be spending the 20,000 goon squad to defend that sort of thing when you don't know for sure how it's going to pan out long term. So, oh, I love this from year end. I really, really do. That early optimization center, Game Slayer also in a patent lab. We can see that year end himself wants an optimization center. So he's already moved into Kim's and he's starting these shorts to try and make sure that he definitely is pulling the profit off of these. And Sync, however, also noticing that Kim's got expensive quickly. He's got a couple of Kim labs himself, so he will be definitely cutting into Yearend's profits a bit here. So elsewhere, this game, it is worth noting that Dermis, back in A levels of debt, he's still got a lot of it, but he's done very, very well in upgrading his HQ, making sure he gets his buildings down, so on and so forth from there. Of course, that optimization center as well. Potentially just helping out in terms of his structure value. Always something worth that's important to note. He's doing well holding himself in this game despite the early found and the very, very expensive optimization center he picked up. Alright, claim auction. Finally, where was it? Unfortunately, I don't like the nuke as much as I used to. For one thing, iron's down at $8 a piece. And for another, Game Slayer does have teleportation, which has opened up the option for him to transition that tile into some secondary production if he'd like to. Still takes forever to get it out there. It's not something you want to have to do, but it is certainly an option that you did not really have before acquiring teleportation.
Well, and it's on HQ level 4, so if it got too ridiculous, he can go all the way across the map for a high iron somewhere else. So
that is true. If he did want to take that route, he could. Also, it's worth pointing out that now the nuke is I mean, all it did was remove half a production from that tile, effectively. Because GameSlayer has managed to pick up Slant Drilling, there's absolutely no reason to nuke those tiles anymore. Because you would have to nuke literally all five of them to knock everything there down to trace. And that's just not going to happen this game. Everybody playing it a bit safe.
I think Urand had a really good start, but it seems like he's really leveled off and everybody's caught up to him. So now GameSlayer's at HQ5, and when you're robotic, you've got to get some sort of advantage quickly or you're not going to be able to keep up.
Yeah, it was kind of that classic difficulty we were talking about at the end of that last game, just getting off to a strong start, but then not having that real solid plan moving forward for transitioning. I mean, even this time, I think copying GameSlayer's exact strategy would have worked out okay. You've got those machine shops running, could have just thrown down the patent lab, pushed for that carbon scrubbing very, very quickly, potentially. Hopefully before Dermis picked it up, as he was too busy worrying about debt to run this patent lab full time, which, by the way, $209,000 at the moment. Gonna still have to keep an eye on that as we go forward here. But he didn't have anything like that going on this game here, and so he's just gotten himself into a monumental amount of trouble from not being able to push forward this game. Well, this glass short could be interesting, help pull him back into things a bit. He definitely has a lot of glass saved up for this. Although still auto-selling the little bit that he's producing, a little bit awkward during the shortage. Thinking machines, once again for Dermis. Definitely do not mind that on a game with dynamite, and even as a scientific player, you know, cutting that power surge half in half. Certainly not a bad thing to do.
I don't know about that. I mean, the off-worlds are still going to be really, I mean, they're not going to be great for a really long time. As a scientist, it feels like there are a lot of other good patents that could have been. I mean, Thinking Machines is a really expensive patent, too. So I don't know if I really like that one.
It certainly is expensive, but I think Dermis is actually in a decent position for it. And the reason I think that is because, yeah, there are other patents that scientists kind of want, but I think the biggest concern is what patent did everybody else potentially want the most? And making sure that you take that away from them. And I think that's a really big deal here.
That's true. My concern is he's 213K in debt, and that's not something that's going to help him make money right now and keep him alive in the game. And that's a lot of money to sink into a patent that's going to help you later on, but not now.
Absolutely.
I think he's going to be a big target right now with such a low price.
Yeah, he is going to need to do something about his debt. Of course, he has managed to avoid interest killing him through use of continual cook the books this game. He's managing to keep himself kind of alive despite his high debt. But I think you're right. He is going to have to look to defending himself before he can really transition into the late game. However, I like that he's buying his own stock up right now while it's cheap. He's already on HQ5, which is great. So he's got a lot of tiles that he can use very effectively as a scientist. Once again, he has great territory. And if he can survive this debt, I think he's going to be really well set up to move into the late game here. GameSlayer with 2 patent labs. Getting virtual reality and nanotech at the same time right now off the back of that patent lab auction.
Urand's done a good job using this, using the hacker array. I mean, he's already up to 160K in cash. So I just don't know what he can do with it short of just continue to hack because, I mean,
well, he got his upgrade
so bad. And yeah, if you can use that upgrade lab, I mean, I guess that's... Price manipulation begins. Ooh, and power is starting to get a little more expensive again, too. Does anybody have superconductor?
I do believe Dermis picked it up, yeah. And he's got those solar panels in position for this, which is a big deal for him.
Yes. Maybe that can cut out some of his debt.
Let's see. Yuren's sitting on an adrenaline boost, a power surge, and a dynamite. He's made sure that he's hitting his black market cooldown pretty frequently this game, it seems, but just hasn't really had a whole lot to do with it. Also, he's going to have to be looking to do that.
Man. I just can't believe that adrenaline boosts are still at 6K with all this money to be made on world.
Yeah, I mean, power right now in particular. 110 on power, you could pretty easily adrenaline boost that out. Knock that price down immediately. Oh, and GameSlayer, he is going to be our first to move into an off-world.
He's moving into 2 off-worlds.
Well, they're cheap.
His second one's going up.
You know, compared to everybody else. And I'm unsure about this. GameSlayer doesn't have thinking machines. Dynamite's available this game.
And EMPs are still EMPs are still cheap. Dynamite's still cheap. And did he? Yeah, he put the second one on top of a resource too.
Exactly. So it's vulnerable to the cheap nukes. And Dermot should be more than happy to throw those at it. I mean,
absolutely.
All right, Dermot's making his own off-world move now. As you said, a lot of money to be made on world. I do like that Dermis has got his efficient steel technology running here, making 250 a piece off those tiles. That is no small amount of cash.
And Dermis is going into an off-world too. By the way, with these new black market icons, I had no idea how Dermis was staying afloat. He just keeps buying the cook the books every time he has a black market.
Absolutely, just cooking the books all the time in the mid game. I do think he's at the point where he doesn't have to do that anymore, so that'll definitely allow him to get a bit aggressive here. And you can see already people just focusing on Gameslayer's offworlds. He still has the other one gooned, of course. Once again, underground nukes to blast through that if people would like.
A dirty rat trying to break our stun.
And that's exactly what's going to happen. Yuran drops a nuke on it, identifies he can hit that tile easily.
Let this be a lesson.
And Gameslayer, this double offworld, I really don't like it. I just don't.
And even, yeah, the offworlds, I mean, the offworlds are decent, but, I mean, there's still money out there for, you know, if you go in, there are a number of things. I mean, water's a decent price. Look at electronics. You can make, you know, 113 a second just off of electronics. I mean, if you get an engineering lab boosting that, that's really where you need to do. I mean, as soon as he starts repairing, that's going to be an expensive offworld repair.
Yeah, both of them. And with Dynamite this game, I really, now,
yeah.
Dermis, I can definitely forgive the offworld since he has that thinking machines ready to go against this Dynamite. But, and he's also Dermis only heading for just the one offworld initially while Goon Squads were still purchasable, whereas Gameslayer, he hits two, suddenly it's just two targets that people have to knock him down.
And honestly, he looks the scariest, so he's going to get all of the black market attention. Meanwhile, Dermis's offworld is just going to stay, it's just going to stay up for the most part, I would imagine.
All right, quick little freeze onto this off-world now. That can also be easily followed up with a Dynamite, just to add to the pain, for sure. Oh, and Dermis is going to be our first player to get aggressive. This is important here. In sync, having not purchased all of his stock, Dermis decides to take off a little chunk of both him and Gameslayer, feeling pretty confident this game, it would seem. Still quite solidly cooking the books with an absolutely perfect bond rating while $113,000 in debt right now. That's impressive. All right. I have been loving, by the way, these wind turbines out of NSYNC over the course of this game. I just want to check very quickly this charts and graphs here. Let's see. We'll go to production NSYNC. We'll check on those nukes very quickly. But he's sold almost, like, overall, almost $200,000 of power this game. That is a
lot. And he didn't even get to the power until late too. So that's really impressive.
Yeah, it's just riding these fluctuations this whole time as everyone else is forced to move in and out of these solar panels. Gameslayer, it's been going all right for him too, I imagine, on the back of these geotherms. But he's also had these optimization centers and like this pleasure dome up, which is cutting into that potentially. And it's just interesting thing to be looking at this game.
Looking at tech, you can see that both Dermis and Year-End have identified some good markets to put the tech into. I didn't realize that that Dermis had as much tech as he does. He's doing a fantastic job with that, especially in the electronics.
Absolutely. I mean, that one optimization center, but with a 40% bonus on it. That's an impressive building, and still his steel. I don't really like that he's scrapped his steel here, but I understand why he had to do it. It really sucks, because steel is by far his best market to be in. But he wanted to use thinking machines, and he did not want to be too vulnerable to power surges. I don't know if it was exactly the right move, but I do understand his electing to put an off-world market over there instead of next to his other market. Man, Gameslayer and Dermis pretty much locked into it now, but Dermis seeming to run a bit behind at the moment. He is going to be relying on thinking machines to carry him through. That said, Gameslayer certainly not making much money off these offworlds at this point. I'm kind of curious how many launches he's gotten off. Two. Gameslayer's managed to launch twice so far.
Wow, Dermis's stock has really shot back up because he was making almost $1,000 a second on power, and he's all the way down to only $73,000 in debt.
Mm-hmm. These superconductor solar panels. Superconductor's
fantastic. And now he's got two launches going, so... Wow.
With thinking machines.
With thinking machines, which is really important.
Oh, and a boost on this steel plus off-world. Probably worth it, and I think that cost him about 20,000. That's when you're starting to push into boosts really being a questionable buy. But I think he's doing okay for the moment.
Oh, and Sync jumping in. Oh, no.
That could make things interesting. So what are we looking at? Dermis needs 335 at the moment in order to clean this up, whereas Gameslayer, he's looking at 485. Of course, in sync, buying that last little bit of stock means it's a little bit harder for Gameslayer to get the actual last five, but at least he doesn't have to purchase all six. Just something to consider. I'm going to have to math all of that out at some point, just to see what kind of impact it is on how easy it is to buy somebody after that recent change went in.
Wow, I don't know about that freeze right there. On Dermis, it's only going to shut the off-world down for about 15 seconds because of thinking machines. I don't know why you do that one.
Yeah, I mean, it feels like a bit of a desperation move. Like, I have to do something. But scientific thinking machines.
Off-world shipment. Well, but that was... all the money. Yeah, I guess that was Gameslayer targeting him, but still. Oh, and your end's in D.
Yeah, your end can't contribute to this black market fight anymore. Not a good thing for him. And of course, that's going to keep his stock price cheap if people eventually turn their eyes to him. Dermis over here and Gameslayer writing very, very similar amounts of cash. But as we talked about before, Dermis' stock price is just so high right now. His structure value, very, very strong in particular, helping him out. And all that debt he's paid off really contributing. Gameslayer, in fact, pays down debt just trying to stay alive a little bit longer in this game. That said, I think we're going to see Dermis get that kill on Gameslayer very, very quickly. He can worry about NSYNC, but of course Gameslayer has already bought so much stock. Wow, Gameslayer, this is a desperation move right here.
Oh.
Yeah.
Just trying to get eyeballs off of him for the time being, and it could work out. Suddenly this says, well, Gameslayer, I don't need to buy him to get my own stock back. And on top of that, Dermis is feeling the need to buy his own stock back up now. It's an interesting play that we almost never see, but can be quite valuable in the right situation.
So if I were Dermis, I'd almost think about selling out a Gameslayer and going after NSYNC with all that cash, because he has a $29 stock price and he's pretty valuable too.
I think it's a bit of a harder call here. I mean, once again,
you've already got the stock in Gameslayer, I guess. So.
Yeah, you've already got the stock, and Gameslayer still does have two of yours. And on top of that, NSYNC sold out of you as well. So if you get Gameslayer secured, you're functioning on 20 stock total.
Yes.
Owning all your own, 21 stock total. I still think it's the right call. Your stock is being
bought. I thought Gameslayer sold out of his stock, out of Dermis's stock. Did he buy back in?
He bought one back in. And I'm not entirely sure why. It might have been a misclick.
Oh, yeah.
And so he ended up having two of Dermis's stock when he got bought out.
Oh,
eliminated
wow.
from this game. This does mean, though, we have a game three for sure, which I'm definitely going to be happy about. Gameslayer, probably not so much. And Gameslayer in particular, out of almost all off-world trading company players, Gameslayer does seem to be the one that gets most affected in our competitions by momentum in particular. When he's winning, he's usually winning, but when he's losing, it's harder for him to pull back out of it. So this loss, not going to be a good thing for him at all mentally.
Good move by NSYNC to go on your end, considering how cheap his stock is. That's really going to boost it up.
Yeah, that's definitely going to give NSYNC potentially an in back into this game. I mean, look at this. NSYNC and Dermis sitting on very similar amounts of cash, both of them with a subsidiary. Dermis definitely with the edge still. I have to actually pay attention and look around the map to see off-world counts. I'm a little worried about the fact that NSYNC and Year-End, though. Year-End's got the two off-worlds. NSYNC only has the one. That's definitely a concern this game, I would say. And another concern potentially for NSYNC is the fact that Dermis, as we've discussed, that optimization center running for so long, doesn't look like it's been active for quite some time now. But of course, all those optimizations are still there, functioning very, very well on these farms, can easily move into reactors, whereas NSYNC, all he's really got is food tech, it's not even up to three yet, almost there, and electronics tech for things that are actually helpful right now.
It looks like Dermis has stopped paying attention to what's being launched too, because he's launching oxygen, which is only 18k, and that's auto launch. So he's losing a lot of money just from those launches.
Yeah, I'm wondering if either of our players have spotted the electronics. It does look like NSYNC has. He's been auto launching chems and electronics. Electronics definitely the correct option out of those two for a while, but definitely something you got to pay attention to is your off-world market in a game where prices are this close and there's no obvious just, oh, well, I just launched this for the rest of the game. Things not looking good for NSYNC still. He's doing a really good job, I think, trying to hold on in such an awkward game, especially where he was, I believe, our last player to found. Kind of did a good job of picking markets that other people weren't in to make sure he was existing there. But Gameslayer is just worth so much to have purchased. He's got strong, expansive production with that teleportation. Of course, the Pleasure Dome that has virtual reality and the double off-world market finally doing some good work for Dermis this game, even if Gameslayer didn't get a whole lot of benefit out of him.
Dermis making double the money off of his subsidiary that NSYNC is, so that this looks like it's pretty close to over.
Yeah, it's starting to definitely push that direction. Dermis only needing about 560,000 to clean this up. NSYNC, he is still going to be looking at more like, oh, I shouldn't be trying to do math right now. Probably about 800,000, I would guess, remaining for NSYNC to buy up Dermis. And so I would agree with you. This one's looking just about over. Dermis with the early found and so much debt quickly. Just that is so great to me in a lot of ways. We do not see Cook the Books make a huge difference in most games, but I have to say, I think it saved Dermis's life this game.
And that might be why you found it early, because as soon as you see Cook the Books, you can just string it along for such a long time without having to worry about it.
Absolutely. I think that definitely could have played a factor in Dermis choosing when and where to found this game, and possibly even how far he pushed on that optimization center, knowing that he was not going to be punished for a play like that this game. Very outside circumstance, but it's great to see it used so effectively.
And we got it.
Yep. So game two, on over to Dermis. Let's go ahead and take a look at how that game played out very quickly. Nice little overview. See, I think this is kind of a big deal, is that Gameslayer, he only ever made 339,000 off of his off-worlds. I wonder how much money he spent repairing those over the course of this game. That could not have been pleasant. I mean, biggest money sink was glass at 203,000. That'll potentially kind of give you a clue as to what was going on. Year end with a glass sink of 500,000. I think that was just mostly him playing with the hacker array, though. He still managed to sell over 1 million of glass this game. Still, though, an interesting game. Didn't really go the way I expected it to in a lot of ways. But Dermis, I just love to see how Dermis managed to actually use the situation he was given to come up with a win that time, because I don't think I've very often seen any game like that.
That was very well played by him. I'm pretty impressed.
4 Cook the Books purchase for Dermis that game.
Oh, only 4?
Only wow. 4. I mean, Gameslayer picked up one pretty early for 6. Year-end bought the 14. So Dermis got it for, I think, like 3, 4.5, 10. I can't remember exactly what all the prices are, but he got it pretty cheap that game. He kind of identified quickly, man, I'm going to need this time, and just ran with it. Oh man, NSYNC. No harshest rival this game. Nobody really targeted him down up in his corner. Kind of indicates that maybe sitting in that corner can be a nice idea, because NSYNC definitely a competitor in that late game, managing to get year-end killed. Man, year-end also. The thing I have to question about year-end is I almost never like seeing perfect production upgrades. if there's anything else you could have done, because that takes so much time and money to get that perfect production, that tier 4 production from your optimization centers.
Absolutely.
I have to question the decision to move into those instead of some of these other valuable resources, because there were certainly plenty of those available this game. All right. I think that's all we need to look at here. Is there anything else you think is worth noting?
Nope, I think it's time for game 3.
Game 3, let's do it. Right, hello everyone and welcome to game number 3. Round of 4 FFA tournament featuring Gameslayer, Year-End, NSYNC, and Dermis. Gameslayer taking game number 1 very effectively, but Dermis with a bit of an unusual play coming out that early found abusing Cook the Books to survive, manages to pull through game 2 as a scientific colony. This game, there's one high aluminum tile.
Wow.
And 5 low silicon, so lots of resources on the map, and they're basically all water. So this is going to be a bit of a weird one for our players to figure out.
And nobody had found it up until 24,000, so if Gameslayer doesn't claim that... Oh, good. He gets the high aluminum there, but I'm surprised it took that long for anybody to found.
Yeah, everybody a little bit nervous about it this game. Plentiful black market this time. I do want to point out with this scavenger found, you don't have super great offensive options, but you do have Bribe Claim, Cook the Books, Hologram Spy, Magnetic Storm, Power Surge, Network Virus, which I'm hoping nobody picks up this game, Dynamite, and Goon Squad.
I gotta say, I like Gameslayer's early found there, especially if you're a scavenger and you can buy Cook the Books if you get into trouble, but anytime you have claims or adrenaline boosts, I love to go scavenger for that, just so you can make up the difference for your lack of claims.
Yeah, I do love having claims available as a scavenger. If I can manage to scrape together that money in the early game to make them work. Year-End, once again, Power Robot, by the way. Just worth paying attention to. Of course, Power started off not too expensive this game, and we don't have any offices at the colony, so he'll just be trying to survive on a fairly moderate amount of income moving forward here.
Worth noting that electronics started off really expensive. The colony's not really demanding it, but, you know, to be able to expand off of that minimal power money is going to really hurt him.
Yeah, absolutely. That is going to be a little bit frustrating for him. Gameslayer actually managing to get to 3 before Year-End manages to hit 2, so that's going very nicely for him. It's also a huge benefit that he got this aluminum so quickly, and glass started at only 40 apiece, so that aluminum is really the only potential road stop to him pushing through those upgrades right now, and he's made sure to get the best of that on the map.
Interesting that he's already gone into 2 water pumps thus far. He's not really pulling anything that makes him a lot of money at this point. So he's just kind of scattered a lot of his claims around the map, which could be really bad later on. He doesn't have a good place to make some reactors or something like that. Good, now he's got food down, so.
Yeah, I think the food is going to be a big deal. Skipping power for the time being, which I am totally fine with, I think. Look at all these cliffs around him as well that he could put wind power on if he wanted to. Gameslayer.
He has a geotherm going up, actually.
Oh, does he have the geotherm? Ah, you're right. That's what that is up there. Which is actually interesting to me. I think it's okay, just given that he's managing to flood carbon so effectively. 5.25 carbon coming in per second. Lots of aluminum coming in. So The geo doesn't slow him down too much. If it was going to slow him down a lot, if either of these were expensive, I would have a real problem with it, considering power was like $65 when he threw it down.
Wow, I don't know what to think of Year-End's position at this point, because they're already geotherms down, he's going power robot, other people are in that market, and he's not really near a bunch of really good resources.
Yeah, I like his farm decision here, certainly, but the issue with it, of course, is that 2 other players, our 2 scavengers, already moved into farms, and Gameslayer just flying through upgrades right now. That's ridiculous. Circuit overload. Well, Year-End, if he wasn't having trouble before this, you know, the circuit overload could just knock him out of the game completely.
Wow.
A freeze onto Gameslayer's farms, but too late, I would say. He is already managing to move into another strong water resource to make money. Just a bit unfortunate for our players, maybe running just a little bit behind this time, getting a bit greedy with claims perhaps, just not using the black market effectively enough, but so far Gameslayer's just running away with it.
and just having that early found and getting that high aluminum alone is enough, because he can get to those upgrades way before everybody else, and so he's going to be so far ahead after this.
Absolutely. High aluminum, that cheap glass allowing him to fly through upgrades. And it's not just the high aluminum, but he managed to get so close to it. It's
yes.
Just the transportation time is such a big deal, and a lot of people kind of ignore it for a long time. Maybe you can until you're at very high levels of play, but having all that stuff so close to you can make such a huge difference in just rushing through those upgrades.
And especially for Scavenger, where you have to get over the hump at HQ3 in order to really start making money, now he can go after whoever the biggest challenger is, and he has plenty of money in the to use the black market.
Yeah. Possibly going to be tempted to just churn out goon squads from the market for the time being to make sure he's actually
yes.
got his cash available. Because with these power surges, that's very effective against these low numbers of tiles that Gameslayer is operating on right now.
The market is online.
Well, everybody else managed to push to 3 while we've been staring at Gameslayer. NSYNC moving into electronics. Definitely love that play this game. Silicon, your end has been keeping very, very cheap for everybody, it would seem. Aluminum never got too out of control because everybody identified, man, I have to have aluminum. So everybody took aluminum, and aluminum's been running just fine. And then, of course, with carbon access, NSYNC, he knows that carbon's never going to get too out of control for a while. So these electronics factories really make a lot of sense out of him this game, I think.
I'd like to see Gameslayer purchase a couple more of the power surges as opposed to going for the goon squads, mostly because a goon squad's not going to protect you very well from a power surge. But meanwhile, if you make that power surge really expensive, you're essentially protecting yourself.
It's true. That is always one thing to consider when purchasing black market, is if you get it cheap, everybody else has to pay for a lot. And that's always nice for you.
Man. And now that the power surge is even more deadly, I mean, it can go around the goon squads versus before it might bounce off. So if you can make that a lot more expensive, it protects you even better than just buying a goon squad that protects one tile.
What an interesting pleasure dome. I mean, it's rather wretchedly placed. That said, it's a good patent spot, potentially.
16. I guess so, but that's a lot of debt, and then you tear it down, and then chemicals are still expensive anyway.
And maybe you just take it and leave the Pleasure Dome there
pleasure
just to
dome
hurt Dermis and NSYNC, who have already taken Pleasure Dome locations this game.
You're essentially paying 28,000 for a claim. I'm not sure that I'd go that high. 28,000 is a lot for
that's
that.
That's a lot of money. Like, look, it's making 140, and that's fine.
Oh, that's good.
But was it really worth $28,000 of debt? Maybe it was. Maybe Pleasure Dome's just that good these days, but that is a lot of debt to take on for that.
And
that said, none of our players were in much.
Two more Pleasure Domes are coming online. Dermis is already building his other one. I wonder if maybe she'd cancel that, or I don't know, or get virtual reality.
Well, it is a really nice Pleasure Dome, you know? I mean, it's got those 4 adjacency available to it. I am wondering what he's going to do with this tile long term. Is he just going to leave it there? Is he going to transition into something else? Got a lot of options for how to handle that, but he is still back at HQ3. Might have been one of the reasons he honestly... Oh, stop.
Oh, no.
Not network viruses. Why? Anyway, one of the reasons you could have pushed so much for that dome is it is going to be more money than just the single dome. And on top of that, your HQ3, you have got to find some kind of cash flow to push you back into this game when Gameslayer's been sitting on 5 for so long.
What was the reason for that network virus there on Gameslayer? It doesn't really do much.
I'm not sure. Could have been testing for a hologram. It is worth noting that Gameslayer has picked a hologram up and simply has not used it at this point. Year-end also, by the way, using a hologram to hide his patent lab at the moment. Which is after
I would have rather see a spy on there instead of, I mean, spies are 3,000 and they'll cover a whole lot more than, you know, potentially the network virus, so.
It's true.
The black market.
Also possible that someone in NSYNC in particular trying to control carbon to some degree and hurt this electronics production. That's what I would find most likely in a lot of ways, but it was a bit of a strange network virus. That does have to be said.
The black market is online.
Well, Gameslayer, he's got to HQ5. He's got a lot of cash on hand. Hasn't really committed it anywhere just yet, though. It looks like he's struggling to decide where he wants to go with this game in terms of handling the late game, because Gameslayer has no advanced buildings down yet. Oh man, power though. See that power price? That's ridiculous.
Wow.
I have to question with this, I have to wonder why Year-End chose carbon scrubbing instead of superconductor first. Because maybe he wasn't anticipating the price shooting up this much, but this is a classic mistake that a lot of players make, myself included. They'll put the patent lab down for a specific reason, but they don't necessarily need to handle that just yet. Maybe there's a better short-term option for it, and just not identifying that. Now he's going to be moving into superconductor, but he could have had it already. And by the time he gets there, power is going to be significantly cheaper.
This would be a great time. Oh, good. Now Dermis is finally scrapping that that lab when it was essentially, it was only making him about $78 a second, but adding about 120 something to his debt. Good time to transition.
Yeah. Oh man, I just, my brain turns off every time I hear that network virus sound.
I know. I'm not sure that anybody really enjoys it.
I just wish it didn't last so long, that's all. All right. Year-End gonna buy up some of his own stock. Gameslayer obviously looking pretty threatening right now with the amount of cash that he's on. Once again, I'm worried about him in this late game, though. I'm not seeing... There it is! Finally! Gameslayer has committed to a transition. We'll have to see how much everybody else is paying attention to this as it's happening. Nanotech picked up for Year-End. I do like this boost onto the patent lab if you've got the cash to go along with it.
Mm-hmm.
You start flying through patents so fast with those adrenaline boosts that everybody else wants. I'm kind of curious, though. He's working on financial instruments now, which I think is fine, if not great, in a game with Cook the Books, potentially, but it was a nice cheap one that he could easily reach. I'm curious what he's going to be moving into next. And, of course, Dermis got a patent lab online at this point, but not functional. I imagine he'll just be looking for virtual reality and seeing what he picks up from there.
Well, either virtual reality, or I'd like to see an early thinking machines from Dermis, just because he has the cheap offworlds and they're so profitable. Right now, the Oxygen launch is a 60K launch.
Absolutely. And that is insane. Optimization Center is finally coming down for Gameslayer, it should be noted. So he's got a lot of late game tools that are flying up at this point. And he should be best positioned to move forward from here, I would say. Now that he's managed to find a spot to exist in. Expanded. I think a lot of it comes down to this hologram, though. No network viruses have landed on that tile yet, so I have to say nobody really knows exactly what's going on. Man, and that's not for lack of trying. I do want to point out, NSYNC with three spies on Gameslayer's territory has not managed to spot the off-world market. 12.
I guess just because those chems looked like they were making decent enough money, didn't even think to look there.
Yeah. We call it a dirty rat. Now, Gameslayer, one thing to point out is that chems are getting weaker and weaker as time goes on, and once he decides to transition them or leave them online to the point where they're losing money, that's when it really screams, hey, I've got an off-world market here. Maybe you guys should pay attention. Let's see, does anybody else have a serious number of spies going on except for NSYNC? I'm not really seeing them. Dermis doesn't look like he has anything. Year-End, not seeing anything either. So it's mostly just NSYNC with the spies set up right now. Just happened to miss the important detail.
Oh, I really like the hacker array coming out of Dermis, because he can hack a whole lot of that steel and iron, and he has the entire market to himself at this point.
Yeah, I mean, Year-End definitely interfering with his steel at the moment, but as you said, he has the iron, and that's
the trick.
Yes,
all the iron.
So you just drive that price insane, and you're going to be sitting pretty. And I really would have liked to see that play out of Dermis quite some time ago, actually.
Yes.
You can get a lot of use out of an early hacker array if you have a solid monopoly. Just something to consider that most players don't really utilize to the best extent.
Dermis is so close to an off-world, and yet he hasn't put one down. It doesn't look like he's even really looking toward it.
Oh, there we go.
There we go.
Just took the tile. I imagine he'll be getting that done. Yep. Hologram came down afterward, though. It's possible somebody spotted that. And if Gameslayer spotted it in particular, Dermis just opened himself up and said, "Hey, I'm worth a lot of money. Maybe you should come buy me first."
We caught a dirty rat trying to break our stuff.
Well, where was that diamond? Oh, stop! Dynamite lands on the new off-world location, but that's potentially also still a concern, because you spot that new off-world, you think, "I got him." Maybe you don't know the first one is there.
Oh. Now Game Slayer's getting aggressive, because I have a feeling he knows that there's an off-world market over there. I don't really like that off-world market placement, because it gets disguised as something that's not going to blend in.
Yeah.
There's no way that he's doing two hacker arrays, so Gameslayer has to know that at least one of them is an off-world market, if not two.
Yeah, Gameslayer started the buy and then just decided to leave it be for whatever reason. I'm wondering if that was a misclick or if he actually intended to sell that stock. But...
Or maybe he needed that for his second off-world market. But no, that's 81%, so...
Yeah, it's getting there. He's also... Maybe he wanted it to buy a goon. I mean, he's still got 82,000 left over right now. An interesting position for Gameslayer, to be sure. One core sample on over to Gameslayer, despite the fact that it said times two, I think, on the auction. That's a bit unfortunate, but... Well, double off-world market to one out of Dermis. Dermis is not defended, but the hologram seems to be working for the time being. At least nobody focused on him enough to do anything about it. And Gameslayer, he's sitting on double dynamite. I think this far away from the buy, there's no reason not to knock the off-world market down for the moment when you're sitting on those two dynamite.
Oh, so InSync knows about one of his off-worlds, but he doesn't know about the second one.
Yeah, and I think Year-End is in a similar position right now. I think Year-End was the one who initially started getting through that goon squad, if I spotted it correctly. But I don't think either of them have ever seen that original off-world market.
No.
Now, what I don't really like about InSync and Year-End right now is Gameslayer is pretty heavily committed into somebody, and he has a lot of open stock available. That is just such an easy target. Now it's all gone, but of course Dermis was the one who was allowed to get it, which means that Gameslayer's just going to get it all back, assuming that he succeeds on this buy soon. And they could have slipped in there and really done some serious damage to Gameslayer, since he made such an aggressive play with an opening like that.
The black market is online.
Well, everybody working on their off-worlds now. Year-End is almost finished. NSYNC, he's getting there too, but it'll still just be 2-1. NSYNC and Year-End both going to have to work together with this black market, I think, to keep Gameslayer from taking this game and the series, assuming he manages to push to this Dermis buy.
Unfortunately, everything that NSYNC has up isn't making very much money, if anything. So he's putting up Chem Labs, but those are only going to be making about $20 a second. Actually, right now they might even be losing money. His farms are losing money, and he's not making great money from the he needs to go into Oxygen or something like that, that would be a little bit more profitable. He's just hemorrhaging money with all of his tiles.
Yeah, I'm also a bit concerned about the lack of optimization centers here. He does have the four elemental quarries down, which I guess is nice, but I would have much rather seen maybe three quarries, two quarries, and then optimization centers just to upgrade that carbon income if you need it. That way you've got a few more claims to work around with, and then your optimization can look at aiding your other resources, which is clearly an area that he's struggling with right now.
Ooh, so Gameslayer is rotating out of those chems. It'll be interesting to see if anybody notices it.
Yep. Are they going to see the mistake that they've made? I don't know. This is when I wish I could see where everybody was looking on a given map at times. That would just be a bit excessive, but it's like, are they going to spot it? I don't know.
Off-world shipment launched.
And look at all the Year-End doing some interesting things with his cash. I'm going to head back on over to Gameslayer here. I mean, he's struggling a little bit to get all of his money together. He did get an off-world market knocked down, which was definitely a bit expensive to repair at the time. Carbon was looking a bit pricey. Glass and electronics both worth a lot.
I'm really liking Gameslayer's position, though. I mean, he's most fully teched in oxygen and fuel, which is pretty fantastic, and he's really closing in on the Biondermis right now. I mean,
yeah, unless these goon squads have both been blown through in like the last 10 seconds, trying to break our stuff. I think Gameslayer's gonna have it locked up, because now he's got a guaranteed launch on one offworld. Even if the other gets knocked down, that sole launch from the offworld is pushing him so close to succeeding in this Dermis kill.
And he gets an expansive with two offworlds and virtual reality and a bunch of territory. I mean, that's a really strong position.
Yeah. But I still think the biggest deal out of the purchase, in a lot of ways, the subsidiary is great and all, but you get all your stock.
Get all your stock back, absolutely.
Exactly, and it's like, I think if Urand and NSYNC had managed to scrape together the cash to sneak in there, get a couple of those bought up, I mean, they had the option of getting all five, potentially. And not only does that not give Gameslayer his stock back when he purchases Dermis, but it also had the option of forcing Gameslayer to defend himself rather than committing more cash toward Dermis, like defend himself even more. That's more cash that's not put toward purchasing Dermis, and it takes longer to get to the kill. I just think it would have worked out better than the situation that they're in now, where, yeah, it's 2-on-1, but that one is in a ridiculously good spot.
Well, now I don't even know how you would catch up at that point. I mean, he bought the most valuable person on the map, essentially, and yeah. You get such a big bump for your stock price when you're buying an expansive like that with two offworlds. That
NSYNC, he's made some transitions. He's had his offworld functioning the whole time, so he's not having to commit these resources to repair that Gameslayer is. Yearand also has a very strong market in the fact that he has most of the silicon on the map, you know, out of the five tiles that were there. Everybody else just sitting on lows, and so he's managed to scrape together some cash as well. It is possible that if Yearand makes the purchase first and then NSYNC hops in, maybe Gameslayer could still get taken out from this game.
Mm-hmm. I'd almost like to see Gameslayer go after Yearand first, since he has more cash. Because ultimately, if Yearand starts going into Gameslayer right now, then, you know...
Well, there it is.
Now both of them are going to go in.
Yeah.
But I'd almost like to destroy the person with more cash first, because he has a low enough stock price, you can take him out, and then you're just snowballing from there.
It's true. The argument for going for NSYNC first is a pretty obvious one, in that NSYNC had a lot of debt. Now NSYNC doesn't have a lot of debt, it would seem. Well, he at least cooked the books a little bit. Yeah, he's paid off all his debt.
He paid off all of his debt. We call it a dirty rat trying to break our stuff. So now, I mean, he's not even a threat.
Yeah, if you look at the meta situation, I think NSYNC made a bit of a mistake there. You're not really thinking about just this game. Maybe you concede that this game is over, you've lost, but you still have the shot of giving Yearand the win. And you're pretty sure who all the players are at this point.
Mm-hmm.
So at least, you know, you would be if you know the players, how they act, how they play, that sort of thing. And so NSYNC, maybe, instead of purchasing into Gameslayer's stock, what he does is he just pays off all of his debt. The moment he starts getting bought, drives his price up. But now in this situation, Gameslayer on three headquarters to Yearand's one. I don't think Yearand is going to have the income to push on through here.
Yeah, not with him making about 1,800 a second from Dermis and such a huge stock price advantage.
Yeah, and eventually, of course, NSYNC, his subsidiary, will get that that I guess it's launching fuel at the moment. That's what it could afford at the time. But eventually it'll get that launch off, start bringing in all kinds of cash as well. And Yearand, no real advantages his way beyond his stockpile of cash. He just goes ahead and concedes it. Gameslayer is going to take game number 3 and the series to move on to the finals of our tournament next week.
And just racing through those expansions so quickly and being able to get those offworlds up, I think really, you know, really helped him. And, I mean, the biggest part of that is that he was able to sneak that one offworld in and nobody even knew about it.
Yeah, I don't know if anyone literally ever spotted that offworld. It was just, he managed to slip it in there, and that's the way holograms will change the game in a lot of ways. As the leader, you can sometimes get away with so much more than you'd be able to without them there.
And worth noting, he put it in a really good spot because he, you know, even though you take away the triangle of, I mean, he put it in a spot that was making a lot of money. So even though you take away the efficiency of the triangle, everybody believes that you're not going to stick an off-world there. So it was great placement.
Yeah, really, really well done by Gameslayer overall that game. He identified the found. Once you see it, it's pretty clearly the best found on the map, I would say. Only thing Absolutely. You really lack is Silicon. But definitely a bit of an odd map to interpret when you're just first starting to glance at it. So that was very well done. And he managed to abuse that so effectively to hit 5. I think he hit a bit of a roadblock there. Just couldn't quite push through to what he wanted in the end game very quickly. But once he got there, his lead was so vast in the first place that nobody could take him down.
Well, so we have our final set at this point.
Yeah, we do. Let's go ahead and take a look. I'm going to go ahead and update our brackets right now just to make sure. We're going to go ahead and push Gameslayer on through. And there we are. So that does mean that our final round, which we're going to have to work out a time for at some point, haven't bothered with just yet, is going to be Heisenberg, Qubit, Blues and Gameslayer. If any of you, I don't know if all of you are here right now, especially because my viewer list frequently doesn't work anymore. If you're all here right now, we can potentially work that out. If not, because I don't think I've seen anything from Heisenberg in particular, then we'll just work that out on the forums exactly when that time is going to be. Nope. Still though, Heisenberg, Qubit, Blues and Gameslayer, that is going to be pretty intense final round. In a lot of ways, that's some of your expected players going through. I mean, Qubit, Blues, Gameslayer, all well-known in the tournaments, typically perform very, very well. Heisenberg, though, with maybe a bit of an upset earlier on, and he just stomped right through his group for the most part. And it was very impressive and well done. So it's exciting to see him in the finals this time, I think.
Heisenberg is definitely a sleeper. He's a lot better than people know.
Yeah, I think he is. I think people don't give him enough credit all the time for exactly how good he is at this game. Let's see. Wednesday, 10 a.m. Eastern is the proposed time for the finals from Soren. I'll go ahead and post that on the forums, make sure people can work with it. We'll make sure to get it worked out as fast as we can so people can be ready for that when it happens.
Seems like that time should probably work. 3 out of the 4 people are in Europe, and then Blue seems to be available during the day quite frequently.
Yeah, most of the time it seems that way. So hopefully that'll work out just fine. But we'll just have to make sure on the forums later. For now, let's see. Qubit and Gameslayer both say they're good, but I don't think we've seen Heisenberg, and we will have to confirm with him for sure exactly what's going on. For now, I don't think we ever actually need to look at anything in that final match. It was pretty straightforward what went on. Just so fast through upgrades into the off-world, working out so well for Gameslayer. And I think that means that it's going to be just about time for us to wrap things up for the day. Do you have anything else you want to comment on, Blackmagic?
Nope, I think that's it. Very, very well played by Gameslayer.
Yeah, that third game was just both the first and third game out of Gameslayer. The first one in particular was so crisp and clean, and then the third game, just managing to get himself into such a great spot that maybe even with that hiccup transitioning into the late game, still such a massive lead that it didn't matter at all. Well, all that said, thank you for joining me today, Blackmagic, filling in for King Morgan. We don't really know what happened to him. Maybe he'll be back for the finals, maybe not. I guess we'll just have to find out, but I do appreciate it when people are willing to hop in and help out with these FFA tournaments. So thank you for that. All right, and I think that means we're going to go ahead and wrap up our broadcast for the day. Be watching the forums to confirm exactly when that time is, and or the Discord channel. I'm sure it's going to be discussed there as well. So for now, thank you everyone for watching, and I'll see you next time.